Who could tell me what made a drum set a drum set?
The low boy.
Kick pedal.
Match grip.
The sock symbol.
My name is Danial Glass. I'm a drummer, author, and educator. In 1994, I joined a band called Royal Crown Review. We were trying to figure out how to take the rebellious spirit of modern styles like punk and put it into big band and other roots music. We found out it was already there. I've been absorbed in this world ever since. I started researching the evolution of the drum set and the way that we play it. In the last dozen years, I've interviewed more than 60 different legendary drummers. I came to a startling conclusion. Perhaps more than any other instrument, the drum set is equipped to tell the story of America and American music.
All of these immigrants coming from around the world brought their technology. Jazz music and pop music were one and the same. You could dance to it. So the first stop on our journey through the evolution of drumming and the drum set is 1865. Now, why this particular date, 1865? Well, first of all, for those of you who know your history, 1865 was the year that the American Civil War ended. And that meant that African slaves and their descendants were free and could start to participate much more in American society and contribute more to American music. And as we see, as we go through this whole series, African Americans have contributed a tremendous amount to the drum set and to the way that we play it. So what else was happening in 1865? Well, for the first time, drummers were starting to experiment with putting together more than one instrument. In other words, prior to this time, you had like marching band type of a scenario, or maybe classical music. And in those instances, a drummer would maybe play a bass drum, or they'd play a snare drum, or they'd play cymbals. Well, around this time period, you had drummers in theaters and stage shows and vaudeville type scenarios. So drummers started thinking, well, how can we have one guy do the job of many? And so this is a very interesting time period, and that's why we're beginning here. So what was the most popular kind of music that was happening in America in 1865? Well, as we said earlier, it was actually marching band music, because there was no jazz, there was no rock, you know, there was no blues to speak of. This was before all that time. So you had marching bands, and the feel, marching feel, involved rudiments, it involved bass drum, kind of on one and three, right? Boom, chick, boom, chick, one, two, three, four. So you had kind of this boom, chick thing going on. So the drummers that were taking this idea of playing more than one instrument at once, we're taking this concept of marching and started playing a bass drum and a snare drum together at the same time, but without a pedal. And they developed a really interesting technique called double drumming. You'll notice that the style that I used in playing that little demonstration had what we call a two feel, where the bass drum comes on beats one and three. One, two, three, four, boom, chick, boom, chick, boom. So it's very downbeat heavy, and you know, it's music that's designed to help large groups of soldiers march down a field from one end to the other. So it's very simple and straightforward. And as we move more towards the next segment we're going to get into, which is ragtime music, this kind of basic march idea starts to become syncopated. It starts to swing a little more, starts to dance a little more, and starts to move more towards dance music. The next stop on our journey through the evolution of the drum set is 1890. Now, in 1890, there was a really interesting new kind of music that was coming up, that was kind of taking America by storm, and that music was called ragtime ragtime, okay? And what was cool about ragtime, it had this kind of new feel to it, this sort of syncopated feel that came from African-American piano players and banjo players and guitar players. It had this cool kind of this sort of thing we call syncopation. And that made people dance, made them go crazy. They love to dance to it. So ragtime comes up and it becomes really popular in the 1890s. And by the turn of the century into the 20th century, it becomes probably the most popular kind of music in America. So how were drummers involved with ragtime? Well, interestingly, we talked about in the previous segment that, you know, drummers were still really in a kind of a marching scenario, playing a lot of rudiments. And remember, the drum set at this time really isn't a drum set that we had today. We didn't have ride cymbals, we didn't have crash cymbals, we didn't have big tunable tom-toms, we didn't have a lot of fancy hardware. So drummers really had very little to work with to create the rhythms that they were going to create behind ragtime. But one of the fun things that started to happen was that drummers began to improvise more. So even though you hear the sound of rudiments, now drummers are kind of getting crazy with it, and they were utilizing them all over the place and improvising with them with this cool new sense of swing. Another interesting thing that was happening around 1890 was that tons and tons of immigrants were flowing into America from all different parts of the world, many different countries, many different regions. So you had Asians coming, you had people coming from Turkey and Greece, you had people coming from Europe. And all of these different people were bringing their ethnic instruments with them, they were bringing their drum making technology, their cymbal making technology. And as a result of that, drummers that were here in America who were doing this ragtime drumming and playing these different theater shows and you know, these new kinds of music that were happening started to borrow these ethnic immigrant instruments and add them onto the very basic drum set, which we had said basically just consisted of marching instruments, bass drum, snare drum, and a cymbal. So they started putting all that together and you get this cool new sound and feel called ragtime. Contraptions that the immigrant groups were bringing with them to America and that drummers were borrowing started to become part of the very earliest drum sets. And of course, eventually, this term contraption was shortened down to traps. So literally, drummers during the last couple decades of the 1800s and the first few decades of the 1900s, right on up to about 1930, were called trap drummers. That's actually the way we didn't call it a drum set. We call it a trap set, and they were called trap drummers. The next stop in our journey through the evolution of the drum set and drum set playing is 1909. And this date is super important for all us drummers today because it was the date that the Ludwig family patented their famous bass drum pedal design. Now, we'll get to this pedal in a second, but certainly pedals had been around for a while. I've seen a photo from 1840 that showed a very crude operated foot device, but probably by 1870, in the 1870s, it was standard for drummers to use what was called an overhang pedal. And this was a real interesting device. It was also fairly primitive in that it actually attached to the top of the bass drum and went over the top, and then this spring thing came down and had this footboard, and you'd hit the footboard and this little beater thing that was attached to the spring would whap, go in and hit the drum. Now, the overhang pedal design was really clunky. It was hard to get control over it. It was hard to play it quickly. And if you remember, we talked about double drumming. Most drummers in the 1870s actually preferred to do double drumming without any pedal at all as a way to play multiple drums rather than use one of these overhang pedals because they were so clumsy and hard to use. So this is a Ludwig pedal. This one is actually a little bit later. This one's from 1924, but it's very similar to the earliest pedals. And What always blows me away, we think, oh gosh, 1909, you know, that's over 100 years ago. Obviously, you know, what we have today is so much better than what those guys came up with back then. But in reality, we're still using the exact same pedal for the most part that they were using over 100 years ago. That's how durable and well thought out this design was. And as you could see, you basically have a spring, an adjustable spring. You have kind of a classic footboard, and that just does the same deal, pulls it down. You have a way to attach it to the hoop of your bass drum and tighten it down, and indeed you even have two different adjustments there, just like you do on most modern pedals. So this guy, you know, has been around for a long time. Now, a couple of the things that, you know, again, we think we're so advanced today, well, these guys had a lot of real cool advancements going on as well. One of those is that early pedals often actually had a cymbal attached to the bass drum, and they would have a little thing coming out of here. This one has an attachment for it that you can see here, a little clanger. So when you press down on the footboard, this little clanger would come up and hit the cymbal that was attached to the batter head of your bass drum. So when the bass drum hit, wham, it would get that clanging effect. The other thing you'll notice about this pedal that's a little different is this beater ball. Now, we've probably seen felt beaters before, but back in the day, they really had larger beaters. And again, this is because the bass drums of the time were much larger. They were often 26, 28, 30, even sometimes up to 40 inches in diameter. So they were huge. So the beaters really still resemble a marching band bass drum beater, which is a lot, you know, tends to be a lot puffier and thicker. And where it's wearing away, you could see it's like a lambskin in here. So this is a lamb's wool beater. The other thing that's so cool about this pedal that we don't really think about today is that your average working drummer of the time didn't have a car. Not everybody had a car in those times. So they had to use public transportation to get to their gigs, which means they had to carry the entire drum set on their back, because whatever you could fit on the streetcar was all you were allowed to carry. So this pedal, and it is very, very cool because we can do this. Take that out, take this out, pull this out, and now your pedal's broken down, and you could just tuck it in your overcoat pocket, take it to work. So there you go, the bass drum pedal. Pretty cool. I'm holding in my hand something that probably most of you out there are very familiar with. These are a set of brushes, of course. And brushes are a real interesting story, and that's our next stop on our journey through the evolution of the drum set. The date is 1912. And 1912 is a year that, believe it or not, we could find patents for fly swatters that had been registered. Okay, now you're thinking, fly swatters, what does that have to do with drumming? Well, interestingly, the need for brushes arose because drummers were having a lot of problems with always playing so loud and overshadowing the other instruments. You have to remember, in this early part of the 20th century, we didn't have big PA systems, we didn't have amplified guitars, didn't have mics to put on things, but drums were already the same sizes that we have today. In fact, the bass drums tended to be even bigger than they are today. So drummers could still make the same amount of noise, but they were going up against acoustic instruments. So drummers started looking around for stuff that was out there that they could use to play more quietly. And one of the things they came up with were these fly swatters. So you have to remember, this is the age before plastic. So when we think of a fly swatter today, we think about, you know, plastic spatula looking thing. But fly swatters in this day actually were metal bristles like this. And they actually created some that were of the telescoping variety, so you'd preserve your little bristle. And a drummer picked this up one day and said, man, I could play, you know, my little rudimental stuff that I've been doing, my ragtime drumming, my early jazz drumming, but use these fly swatters. And so thus begins brushes. And once they became more popular with drummers, well, then some of the companies that were manufacturing drum stuff said, well, hey, we'll actually start manufacturing these. And lo and behold, the name went from fly swatters to brushes. But for many, many years, drummers continued to refer to their brushes as fly swatters. When drummers first started using brushes back in the 1920s, they didn't use them the way we did today. They really used them as a quieter alternative to sticks. So, you know, whereas you had your sort of rudimental sound, they would kind of imitate that with the brushes, kind of like this. Right? As we move into the 1920s and into the 1930s, they discovered that there was a lot of neat effects that you could get with the brushes. And part of it was about imitating dancers or imitating sandpaper, coming up with sort of different ways to use them. So then they started to add more effects where they would drag the brush across the head, for example. Right? So we get into that kind of a vibe. And of course, by the time we get into the 1930s, which we'll be talking about a couple more segments down the road, they really start integrating the brushes, and the brushes really take on, instead of just being an imitation of the sticks, they really take on their own vibe, and it really becomes an art form, brush playing. So our next stop in the evolution of drum set and drum set playing is the year 1917. Now this was the year that a band from New Orleans called the Original Dixieland Jazz Band went up to New York City and made some recordings that became huge hits all over the country. And the style that they were playing was a style from New Orleans, and it sort of kicked off what we call jazz music. It was really the first jazz, official jazz recordings. So jazz, if you know your history at all, is a style that does indeed come from New Orleans. And there's a lot of bands in New Orleans at the time that were making this kind of music. And it was kind of cool because a lot of the things that we've talked about so far in our discussion of at various points along the way here in our journey are now coming together. So from a drumming perspective, you have guys like Baby Dodds and Zooty Singleton, Ray Baduke, a guy named Tony Sbarbaro, who was the drummer in the Original Dixieland Jazz Band. And what they're doing is taking this idea of marching, right, that we talked about, but now combining your bass drum and your snare drum and some of these what were called traps from these different immigrant groups that were coming in, little cymbals, little tom-toms, woodblocks, cowbells. And they started bringing all that together with this rudimental style of playing and combining it with ragtime, which had been popular for a couple of decades now, which was more syncopated and more swinging. So now drumming really starts to move away from the rudimental thing and kind of turn into its own little thing, jazz drumming style. So that's all happening around this time period. Now our drum set has grown just a little bit to add some of these elements known as traps. And we could point some of them out. Certainly woodblock, which originated actually in China and Korea. Cowbell, which is used in a lot of cultures. This is a Turkish type of a symbol. It's actually an old Zildjian symbol, and the Zildjian family came to the States in the early 20th century, so they were one of those immigrant groups. So this is an early example of their symbol. And we have a Chinese symbol here, actually made in China. It's a newer one. It's not a vintage one, but this is, you know, typical of what Chinese symbols still look like today. China symbols, they've got that inside-out garbage can look. So the early drum set players from New Orleans would incorporate all of these kind of elements into what they were playing. Now, how did they play? Well, they took a lot of those rudiments and they started swinging them. And maybe before you'd have a nice, clean, open roll, shagadagadup would now become da-jizhup, jizhup. So it'd become more of a press roll, and that sort of was more swinging and, again, made people want to dance. So we still have our two-feel kind of military thing going on. We don't have any hi-hats yet or big toms or ride or crash cymbals, but we've got these smaller kind of noise-making effects, and drummers would start to play fills on these. They were called fill-ins. So here's a little demonstration of what New Orleans drumming might have sounded like back at the time. So far in this series, we've spanned quite a few decades now looking at all kinds of different stuff about the evolution of the drum set. We've looked at double drumming, marching drumming, ragtime music, traps, and early jazz, New Orleans jazz. So now we're moving forward to 1919, just on the cusp of the 1920s. And as most of you know, the 1920s are often known as the Roaring Twenties, right? So what was going on that gave them this name, and how does that relate to this music we're talking about and to the drums? Well, in 1919, the US Congress passed a law called Prohibition, which meant that it prohibited people from manufacturing and transporting alcohol for drinking, because there was a lot of moralistic complaints that drinking was evil and let's get rid of this evil scourge on society. But usually, what happens when you tell someone that they can't do something, the first thing they're going to do is run right out and do as much of that as they can, right? So all of a sudden, drinking becomes the cool thing to do. But because it's illegal, it kind of goes underground. And so the 1920s is called the Jazz Age or the Roaring Twenties because everyone decided to go crazy and party it up. And because drinking was illegal, you had the rise in cities like Chicago, but many other cities, of gangsters. You know, you hear of Al Capone and guys like that. And the reason they came to prominence and power is because they were manufacturing and bootlegging liquor illegally. And places where people would go to drink liquor were called speakeasies a lot of times. These were underground establishments. You had to have the password to get in. And when you'd go in, you could drink. And so what kind of music are you going to have at these places? Well, you're going to have jazz music, because jazz music was also underground, illegal. It had been, you know, created put forward. It was an African-American style. And of course, we lived in a very segregated nation at that time. And again, it was not upstanding to enjoy African-American music. So if you went to one of these speakeasies in the 20s, you'd see African-American jazz being played. You'd drink illegal liquor. It was very exciting. And of course, great dancing, you know, and jazz was great music to dance to in this time period. And jazz is starting to evolve now. It's been around for maybe 10 years. And so the bands are getting a little more sophisticated. We're adding more horns. We're building bigger arrangements. And we start heading towards what was going to be called the big band. So check it out. Here's a little bit more about what 1920s Chicago style jazz is all about. So in both the New Orleans demonstration that I did in the previous segment and the Chicago demonstration that you just saw, you might notice that the way that I'm playing the fills is a little different than how we play fills today, right? The way we play fills today, generally we come down the tom-toms, crash. So we crash on beat one at the beginning of the following phrase. But the way I was playing here, we crashed on beat four. So I'd be playing along, and this is the way that fills were played and ended back in this early period. In fact, drummers ended their fills on beat four all the way until we get into the 1950s, believe it or not. And the reason for this was that you know, you have to remember that drums were very loud, the rest of the band was soft and acoustic, and if a drummer crashed on beat one, it was considered rude, as if he were stepping on the other instruments in the band. So that's why this sort of idea of crashing on beat four came from. And it also comes from a New Orleans syncopated idea, which so there was a stress on beat four there. So as a result of those two kind of combination of ideas, drummers always played their crashes on beat four. In our last segment, we were talking about the 1920s, the Roaring Twenties, and how jazz had kind of really evolved as more of a popular art form, but it was happening with the gangsters and the speakeasies and all that kind of thing. So that's in terms of drummers playing jazz music. But just like today, here in the 21st century, drummers have a lot of different things that they can do. You know, so a lot of us out here are what we call freelance drummers, and we maybe one day are playing a show, and the next day we're playing a concert, and the next day we're doing a theater thing, and the next day we're playing in a club, and the next day we're playing for dancers. So there's a lot of different things that you could do, and drummers back then had the same roles. They would take on many different roles. So we haven't really talked too much about this, but one of the really most important roles of a drummer in the 1920s was as what they call a Foley artist today, meaning a sound effects person. And you have to remember, this was back at a time period when you didn't have, you know, you had radio at this point, but you didn't have TV, you certainly didn't have computers. And you had movies, but the movies were silent movies. The technology wasn't there yet to have a soundtrack go along with the movie. So when a movie would come to a theater, either they would have a piano player, or in some of the bigger cities, and as the 1920s progressed and things got more sophisticated, they would have an entire orchestra backing up a silent movie. And it fell to the drummer in the band, or drummers, sometimes there'd be several of them, to provide all the sound effects. So if there was a gunshot, if there was a plane flying overhead, if a baby was crying, if there was a cow mooing, or a bird chirping, or a train coming into the station, or horses galloping, or somebody shooting somebody, or somebody bending over and their pants ripping, well, the drummer was responsible for all of this. And this got to be pretty sophisticated. And you could see sheet music from the period, and there would be all kinds of cues for what instrument a drummer had to play. And so, like today, drummers had to, you know, have pretty large setups in these theater circumstances. Or if it was a radio show, they were, you know, somebody was listening, the drummer was providing all of this filler, this background sound effects to bring the radio production to life. So what you're about to see next is something that probably you're not going to see anywhere today. This is the one and only place to check this out. And it's a demonstration done by William F. Ludwig III, who is the grandson of the founder of the Ludwig Drum Company, the original William F. Ludwig. Now back in, we already talked about in an earlier segment that William F. Ludwig and his brother were the ones that invented the bass drum pedal design that we still use today. And of course, we all know that they also created the Ludwig Drum Company. But prior to getting into that, William F. Ludwig was a champion rudimental drummer, and he toured all over the country and was one of the most important theater drummers in the Chicago area. So his grandson, William F. Ludwig III, has inherited all of his grandfather's traps and noisemakers, and he's going to do a demonstration for you right now of what it was like for a trap drummer, either in a silent movie or a stage show or a radio show, back in the 1920s.
My grandfather and his brother, William F. Ludwig Sr. and Theobald Ludwig, started out the drum company by having an actual drum shop that they would do repairs and help people tune their drums and keep them operating properly. As time went on, people would say, come to them with certain needs and say, I need this sound, or I need this drum to do this, or this piece of equipment. And so they became inventors of sound effects, which we have here today. In those days before sound, the drummers were behind the screen watching the movie and doing the various sound effects along with the movie to make it more entertaining for the audience. One of our items that we have is the gunshot sound effect, and this actually holds 22 caliber blank shells. And then you close this down, have it on the table, and strike it with a hammer or a drumstick or whatever you have handy. The train effect is really interesting because it's so simple but effective. And then they even added this on as a separate item. You could get it with or without the bell, which I thought was pretty interesting. But this has a series of door springs inside. This is looks like it was some kind of a file of some sort that they just saw it and picked it up and said, let's try that, and it worked. And that's the way he did most everything. That just slides in there, and then you go, if you're starting, if the train is just starting out, let's say. can increase the volume, speed, to really give the true effect of a train departing. And they also had to build items that could be transported, because these percussionists were going from theater to theater. It wasn't always the same theater. Different train whistle, a boat whistle. So in the movie script, we say the sheriff rode into town, and these are the horse's hoofs that create that sound effect. And also, we say that the sheriff, when he arrived in town, went by the blacksmith's shop where he was shoeing a horse. And then he goes by the schoolhouse and hears the bell tolling. Then also, as the script continues with the Clancy brothers getting off the train, when the train stops, a dog nervously barks in the distance. Might have been a little ill at the time, but nevertheless, it's a dog. And we also have another sound effect that I don't have with me that's a large version of this. It's about this big around, it's on the floor, and you pull the cloth up on that, and it's a lion roar. So it's the same concept, just a little deeper. This is just a hollow metal cylinder with a type of head on it, and you just slide a cloth over the string. Along those lines of the whistles, we also have the basic siren and duck call. Which has been around forever. But these are all the tools of the trade of the percussionist in the silent movie era. And this rather odd looking item is a cuckoo clock. Which always comes in handy. And then of course the cricket sound.
So you may be asking yourself, when did movies with sound first start? Well, the first, what we call talkies, were released in about 1927. And although this was pretty cool, they put sound with film for the first time, by 1930, all movies pretty much were coming out had sound, and the silent movie era was pretty much over in a very short period of time. And the downside of that was that literally thousands, tens of thousands of drummers were put out of work overnight, drummers who had specialized in doing all these sound effects and Foley effects. And if you think about it, for those of us who remember back in the 1980s when drum machines first came in, you know, everybody was, it's a very similar kind of a thing. Everybody was panicked, oh, this is it, the drummers are done, you know, we'll be replaced by machines. That was kind of what was happening back around 1927. But as you can see, drummers didn't go away. And here we are in the 21st century, we're still around, we're still playing drums, we're still evolving with all the technological changes and musical changes that happen around us. So it's a good lesson to look back at your history and see that we've had to face these things before. New technology, what are we going to do? Boom, we go this way. So here we are, we're still here, baby. The next stop on our journey through the evolution of drumming and the drum set is 1929. Now this is a momentous year. Not just for drumming, but for the whole world. And why? Because you have the fabled stock market crash of 1929 that plunged the world into a global depression, okay? And tough times for everybody. A lot of people lost their jobs, their homes, their farms. It was a really terrible time. One of the things that helped people to get through these rough years of the depression was jazz music. And as we've talked about in some of the earlier segments, we mentioned that jazz, which had started as kind of a small group phenomenon in New Orleans, progressed in the 1920s, really the band started to become larger and more sophisticated. And as we get into the 1930s, and we really head towards the mid-30s, jazz is now America's most popular form of music. It went from being a real underground thing associated with mobsters and speakeasies and, you know, was African-American in origin, but now it's really being embraced throughout the country. And the bands have become big enough that in the 1930s, the big band emerges as the vehicle that delivers jazz. Okay? Now, a lot of times we think about jazz as, you know, something that's more affiliated with maybe John Coltrane or Charlie Parker or Wynton Marsalis, something that's not dance music. But at this time, jazz was pop music. It was dance music. It was the thing that people would go out to dance to on a Friday night. So let's talk a little bit about the big bands and the role they served. Well, the big bands were there for people that were sort of, you know, the whole world being very depressed at this time period, they made people feel good. It was a lot of musicians, 17, 18 musicians, pumping out this wall of sound and really made people happy, made people want to dance. So the other reason that the big band succeeded in the 1930s was with the popularity of radio. And of course, radio at this time was now commonplace enough that most homes could have a radio, or you could go to an establishment and listen to the radio. So, you know, every night, Saturday night, 9:15 to 9:30, you'd hear the Benny Goodman Orchestra play their radio program from some hotel in New York City, and you'd wait and you'd listen, you know. So starting in the mid-1930s, we really get what's now called the big band era, and this would dominate the American musical landscape for the next 10 years. If you notice, since the last segment, our kit has grown a little bit more. And here in the 1930s, some other elements were added. We still have some elements of the old kit with the bell and the block here. We still have your kick and snare, but now we've added some more stuff. We've got toms now, which we'll talk about when we talk about Gene Krupa. We also have still some very small cymbals. We don't have big crash cymbals yet, because if we had a huge crash, we'd knock out the other instruments. And then we have a Chinese cymbal over here, and maybe the Chinese cymbals of the period got a little bit bigger as well. The main instrument, though, that's different on this kit now is we have this guy right here, the hi-hat. Hi-hat makes its first appearance around 1930. And the hi-hat really became the primary timekeeper for drummers during the big band era. Because earlier they had, one of the things they'd done when they were playing their, you know, New Orleans or Chicago fields, they would choke a cymbal. And so that was one way of keeping time versus playing a press roll or playing on the rims or playing on your woodblock. But this was really rather cumbersome because you had to use two hands, right? So they also had the idea, well, let's come up with a foot cymbal that can go against the bass drum. So they created something called a snowshoe cymbal, which is a little foot-operated cymbal that sat on the floor. And then you could do this. So you could create a chick for every boom that you had. Boom chick, boom chick, boom chick. So finally, at the end of the 20s, they said, well, why don't we take these and put them all together? And they had some different, they had what were called hand sock cymbals that you were, like a little hi-hat that you held in your hand, and all these sort of different variations. But this is what they ended up coming up with. And the reason it's called a hi-hat is because you had another, the early version of this sat on the floor, and it was called a low boy. So the low boy gave way to the hi-hat. So now you could play the cymbal with your stick and you could close it with your foot all at once. And this was a revelation, and it really became the primary timekeeper during the swing era. The other major change that you see in drum set playing during the big band era is the switch over from the two feel. Remember, at the very beginning of our series, we talked about how drum set playing was based on marching. So you had this very heavy boom, ch, boom, ch, boom, ch, boom, ch, one, two, three, four, one, two, three, one, right? So the kick was always one, three, one, three. So one of the big advancements in playing during the 1930s, during the swing era, was this gradual evolution to the idea of playing always four to the bar, dum, 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 on the bass drum. So now you get this hi-hat going, and you get this four to the bar bass drum, you get this very nice sound. Okay, so let's check out a little bit of swing style playing right now. One, two, one, two. In our last segment, we focused on the big band and talked about how in the mid-1930s, the big band kind of rose to prominence as the most dominant kind of pop music sound in the country. And of course, drummers at that time were just starting to bring in the hi-hat. This was a new instrument for the 1930s and a new sound, a new way of playing the drum set. And we can't really talk about the big band era unless we talk about Gene Krupa. And maybe some of you out there have heard of Gene Krupa, but he's probably one of the most important names in drumming, period, that we could talk about out of anybody. Because without Gene Krupa, we really wouldn't have the drum stars of today that we do, and we may not have the drum soloing today that we normally have come to expect. And Gene Krupa really was the first true star of the drums. There had been drummers before him that had been well known or that were maybe had done some flashy kind of solo-y stuff, but Gene Krupa really was the guy that took the drummer from being the timekeeper in the back of the band and brought him forward so that he was as much a part of the band, or she, I should say, as much a part of the band as anybody else, as every other instrument. Krupa was up. He was a wild, flashy player, a lot of energy, his hair flying, you know, and he was very exciting to watch. But Krupa was important not just because he was a well-known drummer and helped out the role of the drummer. He was important for many different reasons. And prior to this time, if we go back to the early drum sets, the tom-toms they had really were still almost like ethnic Chinese instruments, which really was where the tom-tom comes from. And the heads were tacked on, the drums tended to be small, and you couldn't really tune it like you could tune a snare drum. One of the things that Krupa did when it comes to the drum set was that he went to his company that he endorsed, the Slingerland Drum Company, and he said, you know, now that I'm doing this stuff in the big bands and we're able to play out more, play a little louder as drummers, I want to be able to take the tom-toms that we have and be able to tune them separately. So the idea of a dual tension tom-tom was really brought out by Gene Krupa. And once he started to use it with his big mega hit, Sing Sing Sing, of course, every other band followed suit. And pretty soon, every big band had to have a star drummer. So it's at this time period where guys like Chick Webb emerged, and he actually came a little bit before Gene Krupa, was an influence on Krupa. Of course, Buddy Rich emerges, playing with first the Harry James Band, then the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra. And of course, Joe Jones, who was the first great drum star with Count Basie's band. And each one of these guys brought their own personality to the drum set and to this new kind of bigger, beefier, more solid drum set that allowed drummers to really step up and show off what they could do. As we mentioned, Gene Krupa was really responsible for bringing the modern tom-tom into the drum set and really using it a lot as kind of a feature instrument and playing a lot on it. So I'm going to play a little Gene Krupa style tom-tom feature for you guys right now to kind of give you an idea of what that was all about. So the next stop on our journey through the evolution of the drum set history, drum set playing, is the year 1941. Now, in our previous segment, we talked a lot about the big bands, swing drumming, we talked about Gene Krupa, we talked about what a drummer played, how the hi-hat was coming in, and this idea that jazz music was dance music, and that's why it was the most popular music in the country, because everyone could go out and dance to a big band. But as we move into the 1940s, couple different things start to happen. First of all, a lot of jazz musicians, particularly African-American jazz musicians, kind of are saying there's got to be more to life than just playing for dancers all the time. You know, it wasn't necessarily super satisfying for the musicians. They wanted to be able to play out and be more experimental and really take jazz forward. And if they were always having to play a very solid dance beat, that was kind of a tough deal. So a new style emerged in Harlem in the early 40s called bebop. Bebop was a style that was very much based on improvisation. And they would take an old standard and kind of rewrite the melody in a way that was much more complex. So how did the drummers fit into this bebop equation? Well, for one thing, you had drummers like Max Roach and Kenny Clarke, who were sort of two of the biggest names in early bebop drumming. And they both had been swing drummers, but you know, they were kind of sick of, again, sort of this big, huge bass drum. Remember, we still had large marching size bass drums at this time. And it was hard, you know, you just had this big booming sound underneath. So they said, well, let's get a real small bass drum happening. And at the same time, let's move away from pum, 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 this bass drum thing, and put our time, maybe even off the hi-hat, and put it up on a new kind of a cymbal. Remember, the original cymbals were Chinese or Turkish in origin, and they were quite small and just used for kind of little splashing and crashing. But now they said, well, what if we made a much larger cymbal and we kept time on that cymbal? And so suddenly, the whole feel moves away from this very bass drum heavy hi-hat kind of low, four on the floor, dunk, 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 dunk kind of thing, up to now this very light cymbal that just sort of floats on top of the time. This allowed drummers like Max Roach and Kenny Clarke to be more melodic. In other words, they could be listening to these new complex bebop melodies that were being played by the sax players or the guitar players or the piano players, and they could actually play those melodies themselves using the very small kick drums and the snare drum to actually play the melodic lines. So this is what the sound of bebop was, and as we move into the 40s and the 50s now, the idea of what jazz music is becomes more allied with bebop. And bebop moves away from being a dance music and really becomes its own art form. So the best way to explain how bebop works is to actually go back to the swing era and maybe show you how things worked then and then update them on a bebop type of a drum kit. So we're back here on our swing era kit. We still have our bigger bass drum, our smaller cymbals, and the way that bebop worked is it would often take a tune, a classic tune, and they would sort of rewrite the melody and make it more complex rhythmically, more complex melodically, and the drummers would play more of that melody instead of just playing the time. Let's take as an example Straight No Chaser, the Thelonious Monk song. You know, it's a very familiar melody that a lot of you probably know. And the melody goes, 1, 2, 3, 4. Ba-do-ba-do-ba, ba-do-ba-da-ba-dee-do, ba-da-ba-do-da, ba-do-ba-da-da, ba-do-ba-da, ba-do-ba-da-da-dee-do. Right? So if I was to play that in a swing style, it would kind of sound like this. 1, 2, 1. Okay, so still sticking with kind of a four on the floor feel underneath for the dance feel, and we're catching a little bit of the melody, but not so much. So now, voila, we've magically changed drum kits, and we have more of a bebop kind of a drum kit. Again, notice now we've gone down from a 22 to a 20-inch diameter. Our ride cymbals are bigger. This is a 20-inch ride and a 22, an 18-inch that could be used as a ride or a crash. And we got a tight, cranked up snare drum. So now I'm going to play the same Straight No Chaser melody for you, but in more of a bop scenario. So here we go on that. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. So now let's move to the end of the 1940s. And the next date on our journey through the evolution of the drum set and drumming is 1948. In our last segment, we talked about a style called bebop. And bebop was kind of a reaction against the big band music, where musicians, jazz musicians, wanted to take jazz and make it much more of an art form that wasn't about dance music. It was more about really exploring the outer edges and the boundaries of what you could do with jazz music. So that was cool, but it didn't really appeal to the average person that still wanted to go out and go dancing on a Friday night. So the kind of music that evolved also from the big band era, but that kept the dance feel of the big bands, was this style called rhythm and blues. And it was also an African-American style like bebop. It evolved as something that African-American musicians did within their community for other African-Americans who, by the way, had started to benefit after World War II and could now afford to buy their own records, their own style, and so became a demographic. So rhythm and blues starts to emerge. Now, rhythm and blues was similar to big band music in that you still had a horn section, although it was now a smaller horn section, and you still had this kind of danceable four on the floor feel. Well, when people went out to dance on that Friday night, they still wanted to hear that big sound of the big band, but now the band was a lot smaller. And so you had to figure out ways to fill up the sound. So one of the ways they did this was the electric guitar, which started to really come into prominence in the 1940s, because now a guitar player could turn up. By the end of the 40s, the electric bass shows up, so you could turn the bass up now. So for the first time ever, drummers could really start to lay in, and they could start to play heavier grooves. So the two things that drummers did in creating heavier grooves, first was to play a shuffle. Okay, so the shuffle feel, that idea of instead of just a ding, 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 which was kind of how jazz time feel had been prior to this time, well, now they could take that whole shuffle feel, the da, 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 and really start to express that in a much heavier way. And by the time we get to 1948 and this song Good Rockin' Tonight, the backbeat, 2 and 4, really becomes accentuated. So you have this doom, da, 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 doom, da, 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 doom, da, 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 doom. Now today, when we sit down to play a groove, a lot of the times in many styles of music, popular music, whether it's rock or funk or hip hop or gospel or soul, country music, any of these styles, you automatically play a really heavy 2 and 4 on your snare drum, right? A backbeat. Well, believe it or not, that idea of a backbeat all the way through a song really didn't happen until 1948. And that's really the first time you start hearing, whether it's heavy hand claps or a backbeat, this song, Good Rockin' Tonight, is one of the first songs that has that heavy thing all the way through from start to finish. Now, prior to this time, it really would have been difficult for a drummer to play a backbeat from start to finish because technology was such that he would have drowned out all the other instruments. And we talked about that in an earlier segment in this series. But now, with the electric guitar, the electric bass, technology in the recording studio is better, you start to have some microphones for the other instruments, now a drummer can really lay in. And so, Good Rockin' Tonight was one of the first tracks where this heavy backbeat idea with heavy hand claps going on 2 and 4, which came out of the gospel church, all comes together. And amazingly, it's a huge hit. In fact, this song stayed on the charts for 6 months. It was that popular. Big reason why was because of this heavy backbeat going, and guess what? People love to dance to it. So, Good Rockin' Tonight, 1948, it's a major step forward for the groove in terms of rhythm and blues, shuffles, and backbeats. Our swing kit has now morphed into bebop size ride cymbal, and that size ride cymbal, once that took over, then they started using that in pretty much all styles of music, because they realized, well, now you had the option to play your hi-hat or you had the option to play on your ride cymbal as timekeepers. They were both valid. So we got our big time cymbal here, and we have kind of the beginnings of what was going to become a crash cymbal. You know, guys would use a couple different size rides, and then that eventually morphed into an official cymbal that was called a crash that was specifically to be crashed. So in Rhythm and Blues, of course, we said the shuffle is the bread and butter groove, and the shuffle is versus this kind of an idea, which was sort of the staple of the jazz, we call it the jazz ride pattern. Now, this was the more of the dominant idea in a rhythm and blues setting. Okay, so I'm gonna play a short demonstration of shuffles, and I'm gonna play first some shuffles without a backbeat, and then I'm gonna add the backbeat, because remember we said the backbeat kind of came in at the very end of the 40s and into the 50s. So here we go. So now we're up to the year 1952, and this is an important year because it really coalesces the dawn of a new phenomenon, a new way of playing the drums, and that involves double bass. Now, many of us here in the 21st century think that the double bass phenomenon is like a new thing that goes along with music that's currently contemporary today, you know, heavy rock, metal. But actually, double bass has a really long and interesting history, and that history really can be attributed to the legendary drummer Louis Belson. Now, Louis Belson was a swing-era drummer. He was a big band drummer, started his career in the late 1930s with the Benny Goodman Orchestra as a young man. He was the winner of the Gene Krupa Drum Contest. Remember, we talked about Gene Krupa earlier. Krupa actually sponsored a nationwide drum contest. This is years and years before certain music stores sponsor their big nationwide drum offs today. Same idea. You'd have, you know, regional contests, and then you'd have a winner who was the best drummer in the whole country. And the winner of the very first Gene Krupa drum contest was Louis Belson. And Louis Belson was a tinkerer. He's a fantastic drummer, but he thought, well, what if I brought a second bass drum into this thing? And already in high school, he has some diagrams that he actually showed me from woodshop, where he was designing the idea of a second bass drum. So when he became a professional, he started integrating a second bass drum into his setup. Double bass really made its first big splash when Louis Belson joined Duke Ellington's orchestra in the early 50s. And he was also, in addition to being a great drummer, Louis was a prolific songwriter. And he wrote his own song called Skin Deep that's on the very famous Duke Ellington album, Ellington Uptown, and Skin Deep was a feature for the double bass drums. He also wrote another song called The Hawk Talks, which he also performed with Duke Ellington, and in both of these were really the first recordings where double bass could clearly be heard, where it was clearly featured, and it just exploded. And because of that, you have drummers in the 50s and into the 60s, all of whom who used double bass, and of course that led to the double bass style that we have today. Here's a short demonstration that sort of pays a little bit of tribute to one of my favorite drummers and favorite people, Louis Belson. Thank you. So far in this journey through the evolution of drum set and drumming and drum playing and cool things related to drums, we've talked about a lot of different things, everything from ragtime to early jazz to big band swing and rhythm and blues and bebop. But now we're moving into the 1950s, and the next date we're going to focus on is 1954, because we're moving into what's going to be a huge style that's going to be a game changer for everyone and lead us to where we are today, which is the style, of course, of rock and roll. Now, a lot of different things contributed to rock and roll. Rock and roll didn't just fall from the sky fully formed the way we think of it today. It evolved out of all these other things we've talked about and kind of came together in some cool ways. So one of the key elements of rock and roll was a style called rockabilly. Okay, now maybe you've heard about rockabilly and you think, well, something to do with the South, I think, something to do with country music. Well, you're pretty close. Rockabilly was a style that evolved in the South, in places like Arkansas and Texas and Tennessee. And it was essentially taking country music, the style of country music, and adding drums and a more of a beefed up sound to it. So drums play a really key role in the evolution of rockabilly as a sound. Other styles like jazz or rhythm and blues had drums, you know, since their inception. But country music was an acoustic form that had come from Europe originally, and they had resisted having drums. Drums and the drum set especially was not a part of the country sound. But as we get into the 1950s, so many other styles of popular music are using drums that the people in the country world start to say, okay, if we're gonna stay current with our music, we need to start adding drums. So the drums start to show up in country music, and especially in this style called rockabilly. Now, rockabilly, kind of ground zero of where rockabilly happened, was a record label in Memphis, Tennessee called Sun Records. Some of the names that you may have heard of guys who got their start at Sun Records include Elvis Presley, Johnny Cash, Jerry Lee Lewis, Carl Perkins, Roy Orbison recorded there. And these guys all headed to the Memphis area to get to kind of, they were all doing this cool rockabilly sound. So what was rockabilly? Well, the sound of rockabilly, a lot of it is driven not by the drums so much as by the bass. And a lot of times you hear clicking, kind of a chick, 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 chick going on rockabilly records, and a lot of people think that's actually the drums. Well, believe it or not, that is the sound of what we call the slap bass. This goes back a ways to the evolution of country before there was drums, and they used the bass to create the rhythm. So the bass would go tuk tuk tuk. They'd literally let the strings slap off the neck of the bass, and you get this very particular kind of sound. You also had what was called a dead string guitar, where they would take a dollar bill or some paper and weave it into the strings, and you'd literally hear chick, 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 just a dead sound, no chords, just a sound, a rhythmic sound. And so, you know, the drums in a lot of the earliest rockabilly had to almost be quiet. They had to be played with brushes because, again, drums was a new thing in the world of country, and they were like, I don't know how much drums we really want here. We'll give you a little bit, but you got to, you know, play brushes. So some of the biggest hits of early rockabilly sound, including Blue Suede Shoes, which was played by a drummer named W.S. Holland, he had to use brushes on that thing. But when you get that slap bass going, and you get the brushes going, and you get the chicka chicka chick of the dead string guitar all meshing together, and you put a little chicken picking guitar over the top of that, now you have a sound that's not quite rhythm and blues, not quite country, not quite rock and roll. It's kind of all of these things, and that's what's rockabilly. Our last segment took a look at rockabilly and talked about how it was one element in the evolution of rock and roll. And we were talking about the year 1954, and on this segment we're going to stick with the year 1954 because in 1954, one of sort of the very first official rock and roll song was released. And that song, of course, was Rock Around the Clock by Bill Haley and his Comets. Now, this is so interesting because Rock Around the Clock is really like this weird patchwork quilt of all of the different things that made up rock. And you can hear them all happening in this one song. And that's why I just love this song. So you got all kinds of stuff. First of all, we've talked about rhythm and blues. Well, in Bill Haley and His Comets, you had like a honking tenor saxophone that was reminiscent of the rhythm and blues bands of the 1940s and 50s. You talk about country and rockabilly being part of rock and roll. Well, Bill Haley and His Comets had a slapping bass player who had a killing slap sound. They also had a pedal steel player. So that comes from country music. And Bill Haley himself was a former country singer, and he played acoustic guitar like many former country singers. And we also talked about jazz and big band, and the guitar player in Bill Haley's Comets was a jazz guy. And he, if you listen to the famous guitar solo from Rock Around the Clock, it actually is a jazz solo. It doesn't sound anything like what we would think of as rock and roll. And of course, let's talk about the drums. The drummer on Rock Around the Clock was a guy named Billy Gusak, and he's not very well known today, but he was a swing-style drummer in the style of Gene Krupa, and when the band came in to record Rock Around the Clock, he just laid down kind of a swing-style thing with some little fills and little crashes. But when you put all this together, what you get is something totally unique, different, new, and revolutionary, which was the power and the drive of what was going to become rock and roll. So Bill Haley and His Comets, Rock Around the Clock, when it was first released, actually didn't do too well, but in 1956, 2 years later, it was used as the theme in a teenage juvenile delinquent movie called The Blackboard Jungle. And this movie, again, it was trying to show how juvenile delinquency was a bad thing, and if you're a kid, how you shouldn't be this way. But of course, it was so cool because it had this cool music in it, and it had all these cool juvenile delinquency kids in it, that teenagers rushed to see this movie.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around 10 o'clock tonight. Put your glad bags on. Join me home. We'll have some fun when the clock strikes. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. We're gonna rock, 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 till the rock.
Some of them would camp out all day in the movie theaters so they could dance to this very cool song called Rock Around the Clock. So Rock Around the Clock really brought rock and roll to the masses and helped to cement the style rock and roll, okay? Now, at the same time as you had Rock Around the Clock, you had other artists, black artists, rhythm and blues artists, like Chuck Berry, Bo Diddley, Little Richard, and they were also writing music that appealed to this new demographic known as the teenager. Now, this was all very revolutionary because teenagers at this point really didn't have the chance to be teenagers the way we think of teenagers today. Kids often just had to go right from school to work. Sometimes they, poor immigrant families, they couldn't afford to have free time, to have money. You know, there was no such thing as playing video games and going to the mall back in this time period. But in the 1950s, after World War II, kids could sort of be kids, and the term teenager became popular. So now kids have a little bit of money, they got some free time, they start writing records for kids. And that's what rock and roll is. It was music that was made for teenagers. So, all these things come together and start taking off, and we have rock and roll. Now, from a drumming perspective, a couple of cool things happened during this time period. First of all, we had talked back when we spoke about rhythm and blues as the primary groove of a rhythm and blues player was the shuffle, right? Well, now, as we move into the 1950s, this shuffle gets more and more frenetic. So instead of it being dun 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 dun, it kind of goes dun 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 dun, and becomes more flattened out. And drummers like Earl Palmer, who was down in New Orleans and playing for people like Little Richard and Fats Domino, listening to this, and he starts taking his groove and going, instead of da 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 da, he changes it. So now rock and roll as a drumming style starts to emerge and starts to get more beefed up. The fills get bigger, and now that we have a straight eighth groove, we start going da 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 da, bam, and they go back to one and they start hitting one harder, and now we start crashing our cymbals on beat one. So that's another element of rock and roll drumming that starts to become part of what drummers were doing. And of course, all these artists have big hits, and rock and roll's style evolves, and lots of drummers are listening. And now, for the first time, drummers in the late 50s start identifying themselves as rock and roll drummers for the first time ever. And so we really have now what we think of as a modern kind of a rock or a pop style of drumming. This is when it first emerged in the 1950s. Dig it. We'll be right back. So now we're almost at the end of our 100-year timeline of drumming and drum set evolution. And we're going to focus on the year 1964, because at this point, rock and roll has actually been around now for about 10 years, and the drum set, as we know it, is really come together. The blueprint for it is the blueprint of the drum set that we still use today. In other words, all the elements are now in place. We've got kick, snare, we got a hi-hat, we got a ride cymbal, we got a crash cymbal, we got toms that go from high to low, and the way a drummer plays in a popular music situation is very similar to how we would play today if we sit down, you know, based kind of on a boom, plap, boom, boom, plap kind of a deal, right? And we've got straight eighth grooves, we got backbeats, so all this stuff is coming together. And I like to wrap things up, you know, in our 100-year journey by talking about the years 1964-65, because something very particular happened during these years, and there was one more big sea change that was going to happen for all drummers that was going to affect all of us. And of course, 1964 is the year of the British invasion. So, you know, starting with the Beatles, you have a lot of bands, the Beatles, the Stones, the Yardbirds, and, you know, later on bands like The Who and Cream and Deep Purple, you know, all the way through the end of the 60s, just this onslaught of amazing British bands that actually had been reared on American rock and roll and blues and rockabilly and soul music, and they took their, you know, version of that and created a new brand of rock and roll and brought it back to America. They invaded America. So 1964 is the year of the British invasion. And one of the key pieces of that happening was the Beatles appearing on the Ed Sullivan Show. So of course at this point, television, everybody's got a TV in their home by now, and the Ed Sullivan Show was sort of like America's Got Talent, or, you know, one of these shows that's a showcase for people to show off a lot of different kinds of talents, not just singing and dancing. They had plate jugglers and animal acts and all kinds of stuff. But they also had, you know, musical acts. So the Beatles appear on the Ed Sullivan Show, and at the same time as you have the Beatles appearing, the audience that's watching is a new generation of American teenagers called the baby boom generation that were all born right after the end of World War II. And now they're teenagers and they're looking for something to identify with, right? So the Beatles come on and it's just a phenomenon. You have a phenomenon called Beatlemania. America was crazy for the Beatles and crazy for these British mop-top youths, right? And so you have a whole generation of drummers intently watching this show on the Ed Sullivan Show. And you didn't have that many television channels at that time, so some crazy number of people were actually watching. Something like 45% of all the TVs in America were tuned into this one program. So you had just the entire country riveted. And what did they see? They saw Ringo playing with the match grip. The match grip, okay? And this, again, we don't think too much of it today. You go to your lesson when you're a young drummer, and generally the first grip you learn is the match grip. But prior to this time, in the 1960s and earlier, most drummers learned the traditional grip. And I'm a lefty, so I play like this, but most righty drummers, typical drummers, will play like this, okay? This is our traditional grip. And this, of course, goes back to the days of marching, because you had a snare drum that came down when you would march, and that had a lean so you could walk with the drum. So you had to create a grip where you could have a rotational motion so you didn't have to play like this, you know, with your arms. You could march comfortably with the drum being at a slant. So when the drum set evolved, drummers just left their snare drum at a slant, and that's how most drummers played, was this traditional grip. Now, occasionally, if there was a big solo happening or you were going to hit really hard, drummers would switch over and you'd see some match grip, but it was not the default grip. Well, guess what? By the time you get to Beatlemania, the Beatles were the very first band ever to play a rock concert in a stadium. They played at Shea Stadium, 1965, for 55,000 people. And this was totally new. This was not something that you would see every day, to see a band of any kind, let alone a rock and roll band, playing in a stadium full of people. Well, of course, technology wasn't what it is today. And you had very small PA systems, very small instruments. Ringo started using it with a 20-inch bass drum. So in order to get that power that he needed to reach so many people, and of course he had screaming girls, nobody could hear anything because the screams were so deafening, Ringo opted to use the matched grip so he could really hit hard. And he developed this cool style, you know, on the hi-hat, kind of buttering his bread, as it were. And he just laid it down, and it looked super cool. So guess what? A whole generation, this baby boom generation of young drummers, looked at Ringo and said, I want to be that guy. I want to be in a band like that guy. I want to buy Ludwig drums like he's playing. So overnight, Ludwig again. Remember Ludwig going back to 1909, we talked about them? Now, suddenly in the 1960s, they're the most popular drum company on the planet. They had to keep their factory open 3 shifts a day in order to make enough drums to satisfy the demand, right? And of course, all these young drummers, they want to play rock and roll. And what do they want to do? They play the match grip. So almost overnight, the match grip becomes the default grip for drummers, and that still is the case today. Most of us, when we start playing drums, we play the match grip.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, the Beatles!
Oh yeah, I'll tell you something, I think you understand, when I say that something, I wanna hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand.
So there you have it. 100 years of drumming evolution and the entire story of the drum set all wrapped up in one video series. And I hope that for most of you guys, this is the beginning rather than the end of your exploration into your history and your tradition. You know, a lot of people think, well, older music, I don't know about that. Music from the 30s, the 40s, the 50s, that stuff looks different. It sounds different. I don't know if that's something that I can relate to. And I could tell you from personal experience, I didn't start off being into all this stuff. I started off as a kid playing rock and roll. That's what I wanted to do and being really into that. But what I found as I have been on my own personal journey into this exploration of our tradition and our history and our instrument is that it's only made me a better player. It's made me better at playing modern music as well as playing, you know, this historical music. And it can inform what you do today and make you a better player. There's a great Winston Churchill quote I love that says, the farther backward in time you look, the farther forward you are likely to see. In other words, the more you know about your past, the more you're going to be able to create your own future, okay? Now, say you're a fan of John Bonham, and I don't know a single drummer in this universe that isn't a fan of John Bonham. Well, guess what? John Bonham grew up in England. He grew up in the 1950s listening to Little Richard records. He grew up listening to drummers like Earl Palmer. He grew up listening to Gene Krupa. He grew up listening to Max Roach. And when you listen to John Bonham's playing, you can hear all of that in his playing. So it behooves you, if you want to play like John Bonham, understand where John Bonham comes from and what he brings to his drumming, because you'll be able to get into his head more, and you'll be able to really understand how to get that killer Bonham groove going. Because you hear that swing in there, you hear that rumble in there. When you listen to his chops and the way his hands move, guess what? A lot of that stuff comes from jazz or swing. Now, it's not only good to listen to, you know, to me, hey, kids, learn about your history just because it's good to do. You can actually, it can make you a more creative drummer. So if you're in a modern rock band today, if you're in a death metal band, if you're in a funk band, if you're in a jam band, if you're in a jazz band, you know, bringing some of these things that I've talked about in this series into your playing is going to give you an edge. You know, you may put a press roll in the middle of your heavy metal tune. Guess what? I don't think there's too many other people doing that. So it's going to give you more tools for your toolbox, more weapons in your arsenal that you can bring to the picture that's going to make you stand out. And of course, if you want to make your living as a drummer, it's super important to know about styles. Lots and lots of different styles of music, because they're all around us today. And a lot of gigs that working drummers do, which is like weddings or corporate events or blues bars, theatrical shows or Cirque du Soleil or Blue Man Group. I mean, there's a million different ways that you can take these different skills and understanding and knowledge of the past and apply that so that you will be more employable. People are going to want to hire you because you know the difference between, say, this kind of a shuffle and that kind of a shuffle. So that's my message to you. And I really hope that you take some time and continue on this journey to explore your history, your evolution, your tradition, so we can keep this going and keep it rolling down the line as we move farther forward into all of our future. Thank you so much. Who can tell me what made a drum set a drum set?
The lowboy.
Kick pedal.
Match grip.
The sock symbol.
My name is Danial Glass. I'm a drummer, author, and educator. In 1994, I joined a band called Royal Crown Review. We were trying to figure out how to take the rebellious spirit of modern styles like punk and put it into big band and other roots music. We found out it was already there. I've been absorbed in this world ever since. I started researching the evolution of the drum set and the way that we play it. In the last dozen years, I've interviewed more than 60 different legendary drummers. I came to a startling conclusion. Perhaps more than any other instrument, the drum set is equipped to tell the story of America and American music.
All of these immigrants coming from around the world brought their technology. Jazz music and pop music were one and the same. You could dance to it.